كانوا قليلا من الليل ما يهجعون.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions to us, خلق السماوات والأرض في ستة أيام, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the heavens and the earth all in 6 days. Now, obviously, as we said before, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really doesn't need 6 days. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could simply say, kun fayakun, be and it is. So why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala create it in 6 days, create all of the heavens and the earth in 6 days, as opposed to just in 1 second, and even less than that, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala certainly is capable of doing so. The scholars say there are two reasons. Number one, it could be that perhaps the angels were already created, because we don't really know when the angels were created. So it could be that they were there, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to show them His power, He wanted them to see the magnificence of this creation as it came into being. So they would see the heavens and the earth, the oceans, the mountains, all of this coming into being in front of their eyes, and you know, and within those 6 days. Some of the scholars, they said that in it is actually a lesson for us as human beings, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to teach us one of the most beloved qualities to Him, which is at-ta'anni, which is taking things strategically, slowly, gradually, planning things out properly. So we learn from that to be gradual when we do things, and to do things properly and with ihsan and with excellence. The Prophet ﷺ, he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he started the creation on the day of Saturday, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala finished on the day of Friday, which is the best of all days. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ, he said that, you know, we as an ummah, as a people, were guided to the day of Friday because it's the best of those days. And so on the day of judgment, though we were the last ummah, we were the last of the nations, we will be the first to stand and the first to come forth in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, after Allah azza wa jal created these, you know, the heavens and the earth, we also completely reject this idea of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala needing to rest or needing to relax. Allah azza wa jal says, ma massana min lughub, that we were, you know, that we were not overtaken by any form of fatigue, any form of tiredness. In fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالسَّمَاءَ بَنَيْنَاهَا بِأَيْدٍ وَإِنَّا لَمُوسِعُونَ, that we constructed the heavens with strength, and we are constantly expanding them. To show the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Khaliq, the Creator, Allah is constantly expanding this universe. And this is a scientific miracle, because science tells us that this universe, which is only part of the first of the heavens, is expanding constantly, and in fact, it expands faster than the speed of light. And the speed of light, you know, would be over 300 million meters per second. You know, I want you to think about that, saying 300 million meters per second, and imagine the universe expanding faster than that as we're speaking. Just count the seconds of this discussion, and then multiply it by 300 million, and the universe is expanding faster than that. Subhanallah. On top of that, Allah Azza wa Jalla says that all of these celestial bodies, يَعْرُجُونَ, they are in constant orbit, not going out of place. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala constantly being in touch with them, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala constantly being in control of them. Allah Azza wa Jalla, He says, خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ بِالْحَقِّ, and He created all of this in truth, the heavens and the earth in truth. And in Surah Az-Zumar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يُكَوِّرُ اللَّيْلَ عَلَى النَّهَارِ وَيُكَوِّرُ النَّهَارَ عَلَى اللَّيْلِ, that He causes the night to envelope the day, and He causes the day to envelope the night. And you know, it's funny, because the scholars, the early scholars, the way they commented on this, they said that yukawwir means to wrap something round like a turban. So Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, and Imam Ibn al-Jawzi, and Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn Hazm, and many others, they derive from this way back then that the earth is round, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses yukawwir, the word yukawwir. And obviously there's the ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالْأَرْضَ بَعْدَ ذَٰلِكَ دَحَاهَا, that after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the earth, He made it like an egg shape. A dahaha can mean that He made the surface like an egg, meaning smooth, or that He actually shaped it like an egg, and obviously both meanings are true. Now, one of the things that causes us confusion at times, or that's been left open to interpretation, is when Allah or the Messenger mentions the seven earths. Now, Imam al-Alusi rahimahullah and Ruh al-Ma'ani in his tafsir, he goes through many different ways of understanding the seven earths. One of them is that there are seven zones or seven cores of earth, which is actually scientifically true. You'll see there are seven cores of earth, seven different layers of earth. So one interpretation is that it could mean seven continents or seven different separated parts of land within this earth. One of them is that the ard that we all have is one. Okay, that all of this, the entire earth, just comprises of one of those seven earths. And there are other earths and other sets of land that have creation upon them, and that, you know, that we are not in touch with and that we are unable to see. And it's interesting because Imam al-Qurtubi rahimahullah, and it just shows you how the scholars, they always like to take something beneficial from this. Imam al-Qurtubi rahimahullah, he talks about hypothetically, if we were able to reach another creation or another group of people that are on another earth or another land that we are unable to see. And he actually discusses the obligation of da'wah upon us if we're able to reach them. And so this shows us that, you know, we're not really supposed to be focusing on what, you know, what this means in the realm of the unseen, and how, you know, how we can interpret it scientifically, but rather we take benefit from it. And the greatest thing that we can take from it is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided much rizq, much sustenance for us, and He's allotted these portions to us, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with much. And that's why, you know, interestingly enough, one of the greatest forms of oppression that we find within the Sunnah is when the Prophet ﷺ talks about someone occupying someone else's land, someone taking someone else's land. Allah Azza wa Jal allowed a people or allowed someone to have a portion of land and someone else takes it. And that's where we find the mention of the seven earths. The Prophet ﷺ says, مَنْ أَخْذَ مِنَ الْأَرْضِ شَيْئًا بِغَيْرِ حَقِّهِ, that whoever takes a piece of land from someone else unjustly, خُسِفَ بِهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ, Rasulullah ﷺ said he would be swallowed by the seven earths on the Day of Judgment. And subhanAllah, this is a hadith in Bukhari. We find many rulings in the Sharia of taking water from someone's well without permission, or eating an apple from someone's tree, you know, that's hanging over the fence without permission, and so on and so forth. Because that's a form of oppression. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allotted certain portions of this earth to us, and we have to be just with that, and we have to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that, and obviously use all of that for beneficial things.
Dr. Shabir, so the first question that we have is, the Quran says that Allah created the universe in 6 days. How is that possible when we know that the universe is billions of years old?
Mm. Well, the word that is translated days in the Quran is yawm, which commonly means day, but like the Hebrew yawm, it could mean a period. And in Dr. Moriz Bouquet, in his book, The Bible, the Quran, and Science, says that it actually should mean a period when we talk about the 6 days of creation, because we do know from science that creation took actually a very long time. We know that the universe actually is now 13.8 billion years old, and the stars, planets, and galaxies evolved over time. So the creation could not be said to be just 6 times 24 hours, but 6 long periods of time, and however long, God knows best.
So we don't know exactly then what 6 days means in our time.
Well, the Quran shows that from God's perspective, a day could be much longer than what we think to be a day. For example, there's a verse of the Quran that says that a day in the sight of God is like 1,000 years of your counting. And then another verse of the Quran speaks of a day, meaning the Day of Judgment, that will be the measure of 50,000 years of our reckoning. There are different perspectives here and different measures of time that we are alerted to. The question of the length of time of creation has become a controversial matter in religious discussions in our recent centuries, because some people insist that it must be 6 days like the days of our week, and that insistence comes largely from a literal reading of the Bible, because the book of Genesis in the Bible says that God created this on the first day, the second day, the third day, and then the sixth day God created human beings, and then on the seventh day God rested. And then the rest on the Sabbath is tied to this original act of creation, meaning that just as God rested on the seventh day, that justifies and that gives the reason for resting on the seventh day. So we rest as God rested. But that reading of the book of Genesis in such a literal manner, it seems to be at odds with the idea of the creation of the universe in over such a long period of time. And so most would tend to not gravitate towards that literal reading. But here's where the controversy arises from. As for the Quranic way of depicting it, It doesn't say day one, day two, day three. It just says these 6 days. And moreover, it doesn't say that God rested. Rather, the contrary, in the 50th chapter of the Quran, for example, it says that God created the heavens and the earth and whatever is in it in 6 days, and no weariness touched him. So we don't have this kind of seven-day scheme in which God rests and so we rest as well. In fact, the Friday, which is the day of our prayers, our mass gathering, is not necessarily a day of rest. It seems to be presumed that people will go to work, they will leave work, come and pray, and then they can go back and work again if they want to.
So Dr. Shabir, the underlying concept of this question is there a conflict between religion and science?
My answer to that is that there does not need to be a conflict between religion and science. Often the conflict appears because science is misunderstood, or sometimes a theory that is unfounded or unproven is advanced as the way it is fact. Or on the other hand, sometimes people aim for a literalist reading of scripture, which is unnecessary because scripture can be interpreted by intelligent modern minds.